international meeting. President Joe Biden talks to world leaders about Afghanistan. Capitol Hill reaction. Lawmakers discuss what went wrong with the evacuation. COVID-19 for kids. How the changing medical guidance could affect your children. And earthquake recovery. Pope Francis offers more help for Haiti. On EWTN News Nightly for Tuesday, August 24th, 2021. Thank you so much for being with us tonight. I'm Tracy Sable. President Joe Biden meets virtually with G7 world leaders on what to do about Afghanistan and the ongoing evacuations. In just 1 week, the U.S. is set to end the airlift and pull out of the country for good. White House correspondent Owen Jensen reports. Owen.
Tracy, at that virtual meeting with G7 leaders, those world leaders failed to change President Joe Biden's mind. He is sticking to his August 31st deadline. The president is worried about terror attacks against our troops on the ground.
President Joe Biden's self-imposed August 31st withdrawal date not going anywhere.
There's been no change to the timeline of the mission, which is to have this completed by the end of the month.
As the airlift of thousands of evacuees out of Afghanistan continues, many, including America's European allies, veterans groups, and refugee organizations, called on President Biden to extend the deadline. CIA Director William Burns met with the Taliban's top political leader in Afghanistan on Monday. The Taliban, before word of President Biden's deadline decision, said this.
We want them to evacuate all foreign nationals by the 31st of August. And we are not in favor of allowing Afghans to leave.
The United Nations says Afghanistan could start to run out of food by next month. The chaos at the airport is holding up deliveries.
But in Afghanistan, because of conflict, COVID, economic deterioration, all these together is a perfect storm coming upon people that just can't take any more.
Meanwhile, U.S. Vice President Kamala Harris's trip from Singapore to Vietnam continues to reassure allies about American foreign policy. And she had this message for China.
We know that Beijing continues to coerce, to intimidate, and to make claims to the vast majority of the South China Sea.
Also tonight, the White House says the president, quote, has asked the Pentagon and the State Department for contingency plans to adjust the timeline, should that become necessary. At the White House, Owen Jensen, EWTN News Nightly.
As the evacuations of Americans and those who helped the U.S. continue in Afghanistan, lawmakers on both sides of the aisle are reacting to the latest news and question the Biden administration's policy and plans. Capitol Hill correspondent Eric Rosales reports.
The evacuations continue. Yesterday, some 21,000 people were evacuated from Kabul. And just this morning, Pentagon officials say, quote, we have the capability to meet the August 31st evacuation deadline. But at least one Democratic lawmaker says he's not so sure.
Given the number of Americans who still need to be evacuated, the number of SIVs, the number of others who are members of the Afghan press, civil society leaders, women leaders, it's hard for me to imagine all of that can be accomplished between now and the end of the month.
The Taliban says it will not allow an extension beyond August 31st, and during an interview called the Western government the enemy.
This is propaganda of the enemy. The enemy is always saying bad things about the Islamic Emirate of Afghanistan.
On Capitol Hill, Republicans continue to question the Biden administration's decision-making.
This president had no conditions. He just said, we're going to leave by this arbitrary date against the advice of his military leaders. And that's the other thing that I'm pretty upset about, is he keeps saying that nobody was advising him not to go forward. And that's just an absolute untruth.
Congressman Mike Rogers adds the Armed Services Committee urged the president to keep 2,500 troops at a base in Afghanistan for counterterrorism purposes. Meanwhile, Democrats defend the president's actions.
I'm very confident that we're going to get this right. We're going to help get our American citizens out. We're committed as Americans. We're going to get our SIV, which is those of our allies and friends that have helped our soldiers, but more importantly, helped America.
Lawmakers listed the U.S. military property lost to the Taliban, more than $85 billion worth, 75,000 vehicles, over 200 airplanes and helicopters, over 600,000 small arms and weapons, night vision goggles, and...
The Taliban now has biometric devices, which have the fingerprints, eye scans, and biographical information of all of the Afghans who helped us and were on our side over the last 20 years.
Members of both parties are calling for congressional investigations in the weeks ahead. At the Capitol, Eric Rosales, EWTN News Nightly.
Out to New York now, where Kathy Hochul has taken the oath of office succeeding Andrew Cuomo as governor.
To the best of my ability, so help me God.
With her oath, Hochul becomes the state's first female governor. She assumes office following Andrew Cuomo's resignation following accusations of sexual harassment. Governor Hochul's background includes a law degree from the Catholic University of America. The U.S. Surgeon General says the Food and Drug Administration may finish its review of children's COVID-19 vaccines by the end of the year.
It's something really important we can do to protect our children, and that's to make sure that the people around them are vaccinated.
The COVID-19 response team believes more adults will get vaccinated now that the FDA has fully approved the Pfizer vaccine. Pfizer can even start advertising the vaccine's benefits. With a rising number of COVID cases, the governor of Hawaii says now is not the good time to visit the islands.
We are seeing more COVID patients in our hospitals, and the ICUs are filling up.
The governor says tourists who do come to Hawaii will not have the typical type of holiday that they would expect. In Washington state now, Spokane's Bishop Thomas Daley addresses the state's new vaccine mandate imposed on all K through 12 school employees. Bishop Daley affirms the conscious rights but instructs priests to not sign religious exemption letters. India's Taj Mahal, that is, has reopened for weekend visitation. Access to the iconic monument had been restricted during the coronavirus pandemic. Businesses near the famous site are also allowed to welcome customers. The changing of the guard ceremony at Buckingham Palace has resumed. The formalities were halted in March 2020 when Britain went into coronavirus lockdown. In the interim, soldiers had maintained duty outside of royal residences, but without the public display. In Israel, vandals have stolen a small iron cross from a Catholic church near the Sea of Galilee. It was embedded in an outdoor stone altar at the location where Jesus is believed to have fed the multitude with five loaves and two fish. A church representative calls the theft an unchristian act. Pope Francis is sending $230,000 to aid victims of Haiti's earthquake. The Vatican says, quote, this contribution, which accompanies prayer in support of the beloved Haitian population, is part of the aid that is being activated throughout the Catholic Church. The Holy Father is also providing emergency funds for Bangladesh and Vietnam. Coming up, religious freedom. The danger facing families in Afghanistan. And election security. What you should know about the Democrats' plan for voting rights. Christians and other religious minorities who are still in Afghanistan are fearing for their lives. There have been reports of Christians receiving threatening phone calls. And according to a statement by Christian leaders who are currently in hiding in Afghanistan, the Taliban has a hit list of Christians who they are targeting. Joining me now is Jody Hice, a Republican representative from Georgia. Representative Hice, thank you so much for your time. Welcome back. A lot to get to. But I know that you were part of the group of Republican lawmakers who discussed the crisis in Afghanistan this morning. Tell us more about that and why you all felt that was so important. What did you want the Americans to know?
Yeah, listen, this administration is letting down the American people, letting down our allies, letting down those who have helped America for the last 20 years. This could not, absolutely could not be a worse case scenario than what we are witnessing right now. There are literally going to be thousands potentially of lives lost because of the ineptness of this current administration not to pull people out of Afghanistan before pulling our troops out. This is absolutely a numbskull kind of decision that has been made by this administration, and now we're watching the consequences of it, and it could not be a more dangerous, risky, and unnecessary scenario than what we're currently watching.
Yeah, and over the past few days, I mean, we see these videos coming in on social media, horrific scenes over there right now, what's happening near the airport and otherwise. Let's talk more about that and also the dangers for those who may be Christian.
Yes, I mean, look, the environment, obviously, under Sharia law, creates an extremely dangerous situation for anyone who is of any other faith, probably the top of which is Christians. And of course, not only us, but many offices have been in contact with many Christians who are being literally hunted by the Taliban right now. And every effort possible is underway to try to evacuate those individuals. And I'm sure those efforts will continue with unceasing resolve until we get those people to safety.
Yeah, and what is your biggest fear right now for those that are trapped over there, especially those who may be religious minorities?
Well, obviously their lives are our biggest concern. I know personally, myself, my wife, many others, we pray for the persecuted church on a regular basis. But when you see a scenario like this unfolding right before your eyes, where the lives of Christians and others are being taken away from them, the threat of their lives being taken. We've already got multiple reports of severe beatings and just a host of horrific things that are taking place. I mean, having the potential to do everything within our power to save these individuals is obviously a top priority for us and thankfully for many others as well.
Yeah, and that deadline is creeping in. I know the White House said it's negotiating with the Taliban. I want to get your take on that. What does that mean?
Well, you know, why are we negotiating so feverishly with the Taliban, a terrorist organization? It's the tail wagging the dog. It is Americans and American leadership, not terrorists, who ought to be setting the standards as to how we are going to evacuate our citizens and others from the country. It is not something that we should be taking orders from terrorists. They should be hearing from us what we're going to do. And it is concerning that this administration continues to go to a terrorist organization for instructions as to what we can and cannot do. It certainly should be the other way around. And I'm very much confident that had we at this point had different leadership, such as what we had under President Trump, none of this would be taking place. When you deal with terrorist organizations, they understand one language, and that is power and strength. And currently, we don't have that in the administration and in the White House. And as a result, not only are our people in serious threat and danger of their lives, but obviously many others are as well. And our allies have lost tremendous confidence that America will stand by its word.
Okay, great. And before I let you go, quickly, how do you see this all playing out?
Well, we're in a very serious fight for the clock right now. The clock is ticking. We're being told the doors are going to be closing in a matter of days, and there are threats emerging, it seems, by the hour as we go through this. So, you know, I don't know how it's going to end. I know we're going to do everything we can until we cross the finish line, everything in our power, and others are doing the same, NGOs, other organizations, other countries, as well as our own, to try to evacuate everyone who needs and everyone who wants to be evacuated out of Afghanistan at this point. So I don't know how it's going to end, but we're not going to quit until it's over.
Representative Hice, thank you so much for your time today.
Thank you very much.
Well, Democrats in the House are moving ahead with H.R. 4, also known as the John Lewis Voting Rights Advancement Act. The bill includes a provision looking to reinstate Department of Justice preclearances before states with a history of racial discrimination can change their voting laws. Senate Democrats also have said that voting rights are first on their agenda following the August recess. And joining us now is Zack Smith, legal fellow at the Heritage Foundation. Zack, welcome back. Great to see you again. Let's talk a little bit more about H.R. 4. What is the purpose of this bill, and why do this now?
Well, thank you so much for having me on. Look, H.R. 4 is part of the larger plan, along with H.R. 1, to try to federalize many aspects of our elections, transfer power away from state and local governments, and give it to the federal government. And while H.R. 1, which is now stalled out in the Senate, tried to do that explicitly, H.R. 4 is trying to accomplish much of the same thing in a much more indirect manner. It would essentially transfer power to unelected bureaucrats in the Department of Justice to pre-approve many basic changes to election rules and procedures. It would be a fundamental shift of power in the way our elections are run in this country.
Zack, I mentioned that H.R. 4 wants to reinstate DOJ preclearances. For those who aren't familiar, in layman's terms, tell us exactly what that means.
Well, this originally came about in the 1960s as part of the Voting Rights Act. It was meant to be a temporary measure to cure the very real discrimination that Black and minority voters were facing at that time. And so if certain parameters in terms of voter registration, voter turnout were not being met, states and local governments and other entities would have to go to the Department of Justice to get approval for certain changes they made. Now, in 2013, the Supreme Court struck down the formula that was being used for this preclearance provision. And so what H.R. 4 is attempting to do, it's attempting to reinstate that preclearance provision and really go beyond anything that was previously enacted into law. It would give a great deal of power to the voting rights section of the Civil Rights Division at the Department of Justice. And this is a group of lawyers that's unfortunately been recruited from primarily left-leaning advocacy organizations. And so it seems likely they would be very aggressive in pursuing their own power.
Those who support the bill say in part that it will increase transparency. I want to get your thoughts on that.
Well, I just don't think that's true. You know, unfortunately, we've seen this Justice Department under the Biden administration initiate what I believe to be some really ill-advised lawsuits, particularly the one in Georgia against the recently enacted voting changes that state implemented. And so, unfortunately, what this bill would do, it wouldn't increase transparency. It would really shift power away from state and local governments and give it to unelected bureaucrats in the Department of Justice to sign off on even basic changes to voting rules and procedures.
And Zack, ultimately, how do you see this all playing out? And do you think this will ultimately get passed?
Well, I think it will certainly pass the House of Representatives whenever it comes up for a vote. It's a bigger question of what will happen in the Senate. It currently looks like all of the Senate Democrats are signaling they will support it. Lisa Murkowski has also signaled her tentative support for it as well. That's still not enough to overcome a filibuster, but it's certainly something that we should all keep a very close eye on because this bill just isn't needed, and it's a very bad idea.
And before I let you go, we have about a minute left, but I'd like to get your final thoughts on this.
Well, look, if you look at the recent voter turnout, the voter registration statistics, particularly coming out of 2020, Black and minority voter turnout is on par or even exceeding turnout of other racial and ethnic groups in many places. And so while this provision of the Voting Rights Act in the 1960s was needed and was designed to combat a very real problem at that time in terms of minority voters being discriminated against, that same problem just doesn't exist today. And unfortunately, this bill is part of a larger effort to transfer power away from state and local governments, and in this particular case, to give it to the left-wing lawyers in the voting rights section of the Department of Justice's Civil Rights Division. And that's just not a good idea or something we need at this time.
Well, Zack, thank you so much. We always appreciate you weighing in. Zack Smith, legal fellow at the Heritage Foundation. Thank you again for your time.
Of course. Thank you.
Up next, Catholic outreach. Pope Francis offers greetings to a different denomination. And aerial display. Fireworks marked the beginning of the Paralympics. Representatives of the Waldensian Church are holding their annual synod in Italy this week as the synod prepared to meet. Pope Francis sent his fraternal greetings on Saturday in a telegram signed by Cardinal Secretary of State Pietro Parolin. The Pope expressed his joy for the reciprocal recognition, which is improving relations between Waldensians and Catholics. Joining us now from Italy is Claudio Pasquet, member of the Commission for Relations with the Press of the Synod. Thank you so much for your time today. Can you talk to us more about this synod and what the themes were?
Well, we have every year a synod which rules all the aspects of the life of our church. But last year, due to a pandemic, we couldn't have a synod. So we are in this year examining 2 years of the life of our church. Although we cannot be all here in Torre Pellice, where we normally gather every year, so there are only few people here, and all the other people are connected via Zoom with. From all over Italy, because the pandemic is not over in Italy yet. What is the Synod? The Synod is the most important authority in the life of our church. And the Synod can take part all ministers. I am one of the ministers. But the majority of the Synod has to be made of lay people who are elected, appointed, from all the our congregation in Italy, from the farther south, like Sicily, to east, like Trieste, and to north.
And can you tell us, how did you address the current issues, such as the pandemic and the refugee emergency?
Well, our church has already started many years ago a project called Humanitarian Corridors, which we establish as Federation of Italian Protestant Churches. And now we are running it together with a Catholic institution that I think you know in America too, La Comunità di Sant'Egidio in Rome. We are doing that jointly together. The betting was, let us try to go and in Syria, mainly was, let us try to go there and helping these people to come, to arrive in Italy, not having to cross the Mediterranean with all the risks they have. And let us try to find for them a safe place in Italy or in Europe. It is not always easy, but we are extremely engaged in this.
Well, Claudio, thank you so much for your time today. We appreciate it. Claudio Pasquet, member of the Commission for the Relations with the Press of the Synod. Thank you again.
See you. Bye-bye.
And finally tonight, the Paralympics have begun with spectacular fireworks at Tokyo's National Stadium. As with the recent Summer Games, spectators did not attend the ceremonies, which featured a military flyover. Tokyo remains in a state of emergency with high coronavirus infection rates. Organizers promise to keep the Games safe through their September 5th completion. And we thank you for watching tonight. For the entire EWTN News Nightly team, I'm Tracy Sable. Good night and God bless.